Bom dia a todos. Eu sou Letícia Carvalho, faço parte da equipe do EduTech e gostaria de dar boas-vindas a todos vocês que estão nos assistindo pelo YouTube, em especial a todos os nossos alunos do ICBEU Manaus e seus professores nas turmas de Inter e Advanced. O ICBEU Manaus, em parceria com a Embaixada dos Estados Unidos, tem como objetivo disseminar a cultura norte-americana, promovendo palestras, minuto cultural e também disponibilizando recursos virtuais para que vocês possam estar comemorando conosco o Black History Month, né? Inclusive, no nosso site do ICBEU Manaus, nós temos uma aba, que é o ICBEU Tech Zone, em que vocês vão encontrar uma pasta que tem esses materiais. Nós temos e-books, vídeos, músicas, que vocês podem estar ouvindo, escutando e participando conosco nesse momento tão importante. E o tema do Black History Month é de extrema relevância para a nossa sociedade. Antes de iniciarmos, eu gostaria de passar uma informação para vocês. Vocês podem estar colocando a pergunta de vocês no chat, e nós temos aqui uma equipe de suporte que vai estar coletando essas perguntas para que em breve elas possam ser respondidas, tá bom? E eu tenho a honra e a felicidade de apresentar agora a nossa palestrante do dia, a professora Maristela Silva. A professora Maristela, ela é doutora em educação pela University of Nottingham, no Reino Unido, mestre em estudos americanos pela Universidade da cidade de Washington e graduada em letras de língua inglesa pela Universidade Federal do Amazonas, tendo um vasto conhecimento no ensino de línguas estrangeiras, cultura, literatura, feminismo negro brasileiro e norte-americano, entre outros tópicos de ensino. É com muita honra que eu convido agora a nossa palestrante, a teacher Maristela, a iniciar a nossa palestra. Seja bem-vinda, professora.
Hola, how are you? Good morning, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here this morning to talk about this relevant topic that is the Black History Month and the Civil Rights Movement. I'm going to share my presentation with you. Can you see the presentation? Letícia?
Yes, teacher, I can see.
Okay,
It's a
thank you. Yeah, so the title of our presentation today is The Civil Rights Movement and its influence on today's anti-racist movements. So in this talk, we'll see how the civil rights movement is still prompting other campaigns, even today, in the US scenery. Just before we start talking about, all the themes we are going to see, I needed to say that the civil rights movement was neither the beginning nor the end in the fight for equality and respect. It shook the United States not only in relation to African Americans, but also to other groups considered minorities. So we are going to travel in time to understand all the meanings behind the civil rights movement. Hope you enjoy it. So first of all, we needed to think about heritage. African American heritage is very important to everything that you are going to see in the story that I'm going to tell you now, okay? You have so many people that were involved in that in the past. And we are still building this idea of the civil rights in the United States and I think around the world, right? So I'm going to start with a wonderful woman called Ida Bell Wells Bonnet. See the time, 1862 to 1931. And she was all that. She was an investigative journalist, an educator, an early leader in the civil rights movement, one of the founders of NAACP or NAACP. Lifetime dedicated to combating prejudice and violence in the fight for African American equality, especially that of women. And you see, she started young, all right? And she died young also, but she was fighting. And she was not the only woman doing that. We are going to talk about many people here today, so you understand what is going on. The next one, I'm her fan, it's Nanny Helen Burrows. She was an educator, orator, religious leader, civil rights activist, a feminist, and businesswoman. And then we think, a feminist? Yeah, she was a feminist. In 1900, she had her famous speech called How the Sisters Are Hindered for Helping at a National Baptist Convention in Virginia. And it had a serious impact in the civil rights movement. In 1909, she founded the National Training School for Women and Girls. And you can see in her discourse and in her work, this intersectionality between race and gender. So today, if you study feminism and race and class, all right, you are going to see that intersectionality is the term of the time, and she was already working with that, all right? So she fought for equal rights in races and furthered opportunities for women beyond the simple duties of domestic housework. She really believed that women could do much more than just to take care of kids and wash the dishes, all right? So fantastic woman, just to start our conversation today. Remember, if you have a question, you can post the questions on the chat, and then Leticia is going to pass this to me, and I'll be trying to respond as we go on, okay? So, what is this of the, I'm going to put some music here for you that has everything to do with this time. Can you hear? This is the sound of the civil rights movement, and you're going to understand why. So, let's continue. Otherwise, I'll be dancing here with you. It is obvious today that America has defaulted on this promissory note in so far as her citizens of color are concerned. Instead of honoring the sacred obligation, America has given the Negro people a bad check, a check which has come back marked insufficient funds. This was said by Martin Luther King Jr. in his famous speech, I Have a Dream. And throughout this presentation, I'm going to show some parts of the speech. I think Rafael was telling me to put the song up because the people could not listen. Yes. Yeah, we are going to be dancing today. So another part of this speech says, we can never be satisfied as long as our bodies, heavy with the fatigue of travel, cannot gain lodging in the motels of the highways and the hotels of the cities. And I'm saying that because at the time, they would do marches from one city to another. And the motels would be written for whites only. So it was a hard walk. We cannot be satisfied as long as the Negro's basic mobility is from a smaller ghetto to a larger one. We can never be satisfied as long as our children are stripped of their selfhood and robbed of their dignity by signs stating for whites only. We cannot be satisfied as long as the Negro in the Mississippi cannot vote and the Negro in New York believes he has nothing for which to vote. So these words, I just want you to remember these words because they still mean a lot. And I will start talking about the black codes. Black codes were created at the time of slavery, and it went on in the Reconstruction. You know, after the Civil War, you know, that slavery stopped, was banished. In the South of the United States, they still wanted to control the work of black people. So they created these black codes. Anything that a Negro would be wrong. And they would be arrested. And in jail, they could be enslaved. Not fair, huh? But that's what happened. So you see that the picture of some people who were arrested and they were doing hard work. And it was called the chain gang at the time. And there is music coming from there. But I'll play later. And then, after Reconstruction, in the South, they created the Jim Crow laws. This picture you see there, written Jim Crow, was a black minstrel. It's like a character in the theater, but it was like goofy, idiotic, you know? It represented what white people thought of black people. So it was, the laws were called Jim Crow laws. So it was a collection of state and local rules that legalized racial segregation. These laws that, well, they were valid from 1865 to 1968, were meant to marginalize African Americans by denying them the right to vote, to hold jobs, to get an education, or to have any other opportunities. So Connie Hassett Walker considered this a perpetuation of the black codes. So you had the black codes back there and you still have them in that time. So teacher, the Jim Crow laws.
Excuse yes. me? We have yes. a question from Leandro okay. Andrade.
Yes.
He asked, what do you think about the quotas in the universities?
Wow, what a question. Okay, the system of quotas, right, that we call, it is discussable. Some people don't agree, they think it's not fair. But if you pay attention to the whole history of blacks and then I'm going to put in the system the Native Americans, the Chicano Americans, and all the other groups called minorities. They didn't have many opportunities, and that's why the system was created. They have this in the United States too. All right. So I think it is fair for the situation, and it's not going to be fair when we don't need to have a Black History Month. That's my opinion. Any other questions, Letícia?
No, teacher, just this, and thank you.
Thank you. So continuing, the Jim Crow laws had this. You can see the signs. The restrooms were divided, and then they were segregated, of course. They had restrooms for white and colored, water fountains for whites and colors, and so on. So you see here, Reconstruction, that's the name given after the slavery, all right? So people were fighting for changes for equality and the right to vote, but it was like, it was a heavy break on all these dreams, right? So in 1865, there was the ratification of the 13th Amendment that prohibited slavery and servitude in all circumstances. But in the South, they just eliminated the 13th Amendment by creating the Jim Crow laws. In 68, you have the 14th Amendment. That means you have equal protection under the law. But if the law is not with you, you have no protection. Think about this. In 1870, the 15th Amendment, the right to vote for black men. And you're going to see how hard it was to vote. Late 19th century, Jim Crow laws are established in the South, and then in 1896, the US Supreme Court declared in Plessy versus Ferguson, it's a very famous case, that facilities for black and white people could be separated but equal. Okay, they were separated, they were segregated, but they were not equal at all. The schools for blacks were not good schools, all right? For a long time, kids did not have the right to ride the same bus as the white kids. So you see how hard it was. Going on. What was that, the civil rights movement? It was not only one movement, it was a big thing. And you're going to see here in this presentation that there were so many things going on to call this the civil rights movement, all right? It happened mainly in the 50s and 60s, sorry. Okay. And it was a struggle for social justice, equal rights, emancipation, and change. Change for the better, please. And then, of course, a struggle against the discrimination, segregation, violence, and oppression. You see there the pictures of Rosa Parks going to jail because she did not want to stand up. I talked about her in the last presentation. I'll talk a little bit about her today again. And this is the only time Malcolm X, this tall, beautiful man, and Martin Luther King Jr. met. It was when they were, it was 1964. Malcolm X died the year after that. So, the civil rights movement. We are going to talk about people, facts, actions, movements, cases, and groups that made the difference and influenced the lives of Black Americans. And I do believe that it still influences, you know, all these people that work there, that fought in the time of slavery, they still influence, you know, the heat of the movements we have today. And I will start with a very sad story. That's the death of Emmett Till. Emmett Till was a 14-year-old boy from Chicago, Illinois. And he went south to visit some relatives, you know. He had some uncles and aunts. And I think his mother's family lived there. So he was there, he was visiting. And he entered this grocery shop to buy candy. And he said something to a white woman. In the middle of the night, this car arrived in his uncle's house and took him and said, "We want the boy." And then they took the boy. And it's so sad. Well, it was a brutal murder because they beat him. They tied him to a wheel and they threw him in the river. Wow, it was the time of lynching, you know, lynching, linchamentos, all right? So they lynched this boy because he said something, "Bye-bye, baby," I think that's what he said to a white woman. His case drew attention to the long history of violent persecution of African Americans in the United States. And posthumously, he became an icon of the civil rights movement. And here you have the first picture, you have his funeral. And it's a tens of thousands attending Emmett Till's funeral. I did not put his face, but his mother, this wonderful woman, Mammy Elizabeth Till Mobley, she decided that the people should see what happened to her son. And she had an open casket so people would pass and see. His face was very swollen. I could not show his face here this morning to you, but you can, you know, you can Google it and you find the pictures. There was an impact, you know, after his pictures you know, his pictures were in all the newspapers around. People would see him and faint, you know. So this woman, she just broke with all the rules that you could think of a mother at that time. And she said, I want all the leaders of the movements, all the leaders of the religious to see what is happening in the South, what happened to my son. So she showed him. In this case, it's something, because it was going to be remembered again and again during the civil rights movement. Rosa Parks, I changed the pictures, right? But she was an activist. She was the one who was in the bus in Montgomery, Alabama, and said, no, I'm not going to stand up. So she stayed there, and it was 1955. And because of her, many other movements just spread in the South, especially in Alabama and Mississippi. Do you have any questions, Leticia?
Yes, teacher, we have some.
Okay.
So this question is from Ricardo Lira. Marcela, do you ever experience any racism?
It's really hard to say. I'm a Brazilian. I lived in the United States. I lived in England. I was never mistreated in any places. Thank God. All right. But probably if I were living there in the 60s, I would have experienced something. That's what I can say. Well, probably I could not do something because I did not have the opportunity because of I was a Black woman, maybe. But I should say I'm privileged. I'm privileged. I'm an educated woman. I have a PhD. So this is very important to say, because sometimes when I give lectures, people say, you know, many people has PhD. And then I always ask, how many Black women you know? You know, that has a PhD in University of Nottingham, for example. So it is hard to say, but individually, you know, personally, no. I people never told me I'm not going to talk to you. You cannot have this because you're Black. Never. Okay.
Okay. This question is from Gilmar Alessandro. Do you think that the world is going in a good direction in the anti-racism issue?
Well, yeah, I think, but I believe it is a step by step. It's very slow movement, because you see, we are still talking about it. We are still going to the streets, and we're still creating new movements to talk about racism and to talk against the violence, you know, toward Black people. So, yeah, we are changing, but I think we could change faster.
Ricardo Lira asked another question. What's your favorite movie about racism and why?
At this moment, I think Selma is the film to watch. Because I'm going to talk about Selma, the city, you know, what happened there. And I think it brings so many details of the civil rights movement that I think it's worth seeing. But there are so many others. But Selma, Mississippi Burning is really good too. It's an old movie. I think it's from 80s or 90s. Yeah. Okay.
This question is from a man using the nickname Tiozinho. What's your opinion about Antifa and BLM? Does Antifa help Black people and BLM in their fight?
Sorry, I don't understand all these acronyms. If he can ask again.
Okay.
Is that okay?
What's your opinion about Antifa and BLM? Does Antifa help Black people and BLM in their fight?
I don't know this name, sorry, really. Ah, it's BLM, okay, sorry. I was understanding something else. Okay, I'll talk about Black Lives Matter later, so I'll answer his question.
Okay, we have a question from Beatriz, Ana Beatriz Assis. What do you think about the Black Lives Matter movement and Wilson in Nafio?
I'll talk about it.
Okay.
We'll get there.
And the last question is from Camila. How do you think education in schools can improve racism?
Improve?
Yes.
Or reduce? Well, I think that, you know, at any moment, any racist move from a student or a teacher happens, people need to say it, needs to express it. At the moment you shut your mouth, you do not talk, then you are allowing things to happen. When you have a friend and somebody passes and says, hey, gorda, hey, preta, you know, in an offensive way, then you need to say something. And that's how I feel that, you know, in schools, at home, in your communities, that's how people are going to be educated to reduce racism and any other prejudice against people.
Okay. Teacher, excuse me, we have another question, kids. I think it is the last one. Are you going to comment about the George Floyd case?
Yeah, quickly, but yes.
Okay, thank you, teacher.
Oh, yeah, thank you. Sorry for the BLM. I was not getting it. Thank you very much. So we are starting here many movements, and you're going to see them now. First of all, the Montgomery bus boycott. I talked about it the last time, but, you see the dates there, December 5th, 1955 to December 20th, 1956, 381 days. You can see in the pictures, people are standing on the streets. Black communities decided they would carry people to their work. So whoever had cars or buses or vans or any other type of transportation, they would pass and take these people to their work and back home, okay? It was hard. Sacrifice, that's what they did, but they could have it. You know, it was the end of segregation and because of this movement. Not only this, but because of this movement mainly, I believe. Well, I'm talking about the bus boycott. I needed to talk about the Congress of Racial Equality that was called CORE, right? And in 1942, it was founded by activists and they were associated with the FOR. And it was inspired by Mahatma Gandhi's protest strategies of nonviolence and civil disobedience. So the idea was really civil disobedience, all right? And that's what they were doing. They decided not to take the bus. In 1942, a group of, black and white students in Chicago founded the Congress of Racial Equality, helping to launch one of America's most important civil rights movements, right? Leading growing sit-ins, so I'll talk about the sit-ins, the picket lines, the Montgomery bus boycott, the freedom rides in the 1963 March on Washington, worked along Martin Luther King Jr. and other civil rights leaders throughout the 1950s and mid-1960s. 1957, MLK agreed to serve on the CORE Advisory Committee. And in 66, under new guidance, it turned its focus from civil disobedience to a Black separatist and Black power organization. So CORE changed from this pacifist movement to something hardcore. And you're going to see all the movements I'm talking about, CORE people were there, right? And here I'm starting with the bus boycott because I thought it was more meaningful to start. Martin Luther King, I believe all of you know about him. He was a Baptist minister, very strong activist, an intelligent man, and he knew how to put things in words and to say what was necessary to say so people would be moved And I'm not only talking about Black people, but that white people too, okay? So he was there in all these movements. You can see the Montgomery bus boycott. That's when he really appears in the national scenery, okay? That's when we have the bus boycott, and then you have the protest in Birmingham. You're going to see about the Birmingham protests also, March on Washington. And then he is the one who delivered I Have a Dream speech. And you're going to see he was influenced by a woman to do this speech. I'll talk about this later. So and in 1965, Selma to Montgomery marches. I think Alexandre asked about the favorite movie. That it is Selma. Selma is the name of the city, okay? And talking about this speech, I have a dream that one day on the red hills of Georgia, the sons of former slaves and the sons of former slave owners will be able to sit down together at the table of brotherhood. That makes us think. And I bring Malcolm X. And then some people might say, Malcolm X in the civil rights movement, he was against it. Well, for a long time, he criticized the civil rights movement. But there was a moment when the things, horrible things in Selma occurred. He was there. And Martin Luther King was in jail. And he came and he gave his support to Martin Luther King's wife, Loretta. So you have there. I showed you the picture of them together. They met in 1964, right? He defended Black nationalism and the Nation of Islam. His idea was that you need Black power. He was also talking about the Black empowerment, Black supremacy, and he did not want to have things together. He wanted to separate Blacks from whites. Right. So initially he was scornful of King and his strategies, but then later he recognized the worth of the civil rights movement. So he publicly criticized the mainstream civil rights movement for its emphasis on violent and racial integration. The thing is that if you think about this nonviolence movement, is that Blacks are being beaten and taken to jail. All right. There was a lot of violence from the part of the whites in the South and from the police. But they thought, no, we are going not to be violent. We are going to be peaceful in this movement. And Malcolm X did not believe that. He was assassinated. He was going to give a speech. And it was a problem in the Nation of Islam. One of the members decided to kill him. It was horrible. Many shots in front of his family. His wife and his kids were there. So, but he was a great man. Ah, the sittings. What happened there? Have you ever heard about the sittings? Yes or no? I don't know. I cannot see your answers. Yeah, the sittings, the means. You sit in. Okay? So it was part of this nonviolent direct action campaign to end the segregation at lunch counters. The thing is that some stores had restaurants, you know, it was like this counter you can see there, balcão, right, with the banks and then benches, and then you could sit there and have your lunch. The thing is, Blacks were not served, especially in the South. So in 1960, some university students decided to do this movement of sit and wait. And then they started, you know, it grew so much that people needed to change rules and laws, all right? So here I have the first picture. You have the Greensboro Four. These were the four lads that decided to do this for the first time. David Richmond, Franklin McCain, Edsel Blair Jr., and Joseph McNeil. And then you have the Nashville movement also, right? That was also in 1960. But you see how long it lasted in Greensboro from February to July. It was a long time. Today, this Woolworth store in Greensboro became a Black History Museum. So you can go there and visit and see the counter and see what happened there. And when you have the sit-ins, you have the emergence of this movement called Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, SNCC, or just SNCC. It had the nickname SNCC. So SNCC was just composed with young people, but you see here, they are surrounding Martin Luther King Jr., right, in some of the movements. So they were so interesting. They were very interesting people. You have there some pictures of, you know, I think the main members. And in 1906, they emerged from these student sit-ins, all right? And the main channel of student commitment in the U.S. civil rights movement. They organized the Freedom Summer. Remember when we talk about the right to vote, right? They would go to Mississippi in the summer and go place by place, house to house. Of course, African-Americans, all right, houses. And then they would tell them how to register to get the right to vote. And people were killed. And that's, I told you about the film Mississippi Burning. It talks about it. It's a great film. Here you have Bob Moses. He's still alive. He's still talking, all right? You have a John Lewis. John Lewis had cancer and he died last year in July. But he was fantastic and he became a senator. He became a senator, I think for 17 years, about that. And you have a Prussia Hall. Prussia Hall was very eloquent and she could say things in a very nice way. And before the March on Washington, she was, I believe it was in Selma. She gave this speech and in this speech she said, you know, I still have a dream. And the people say that this inspired Martin Luther King Jr. to have the I have a dream in his speeches after that. So I believe so, because she was very intelligent. Kwame Ture, or Stokely Carmichael, was one of the SNCC guys that then became a Black Power leader. Because for him, SNCC was very pacifist. And he believed that they needed, he was inspired by Malcolm X, and he really thought they could have more from some other actions, not so pacifist. So he was also working with the Black Panther Party and other groups. You can see there that although there are lots of men as leaders, you had women. Many women working on this, being beaten also in sacrifice. The Freedom Summer you see on the bottom, you can see there are some white guys there. They are students from the university, okay? They're students, and they decided they would go to the South, and they would tell people, you can register, I'll teach you how to do it. And there is this case in Mississippi that the two white boys and one black, you know, they were all young boys. They were killed because they were doing this campaign. So you remember the Freedom Summer. Medgar Welly Evers. Well, an activist in Mississippi, he would go to the streets and he would demonstrate against violence and segregation. He organized many movements, all right? He was a field secretary of NAACP and a World War veteran. And because he was a World War veteran, after he was assassinated in Jackson, Mississippi, he was buried with the full military honors at the Arlington National Cemetery. That's where the soldiers are, the great soldiers are there, all right? So he was fighting a lot, very important to name. Some people, you know, I think out of the United States don't know about Medgar Evers, but if you go in and research about him, you see how important he was in this fight for the votes, you know, against segregation and in all the bad things that were happening in the South at the time. We cannot walk alone. And as we walk, we must make the pledge that we shall always march ahead. We cannot turn back. If you think about this song, I'm going to play a song for you here.
One day, when the glory comes, it will be ours.
Can you hear?
It will be ours. Oh, one day.
This is Glory from the film Selma.
We will be sure. We will be sure. Oh, glory. 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 Oh, glory. The heavens.
Yeah, sorry, we cannot continue because of the time. This is also from the I Have a Dream speech. And think about these words before. You leave your house, you leave everything, and you start walking. You start walking for something meaningful, not only for you, but for your community, for your country, right? Something you do believe. And we are going to talk about the marches. The March on Washington for Jobs and Freedom, or just known as the March on Washington or the Great March on Washington. There were so many names. People really walked there. Some people did not have money to pay for a bus drive to Washington, so they would walk. And they would walk, and as they crossed the cities, they would have black people on the sides just screaming really bad things to them, throwing things on them, and they would walk, right? And they would really do their part and go there. So you have August 28th. Do you remember Emmett Till, the boy that was killed? That's the same day Emmett Till died, August 28th. So A. Philip Randolph organized together with the Bayard Rustin, this, they put it together. It was an alliance, you know. He had the civil rights movement people. He had the labor unions. They have religious organizations. They put everybody together and said, let's march. Let's say what we needed to say. And they went to Washington for that. And from where you see this picture, you have Martin Luther King Jr. and many other leaders. Martin Luther King Jr., you're going to see here, was the last one to talk, but you have the snake boys were talking, all right? You have the core and movement people talking. You have NAACP people talking. They were there talking. And then they were advocating the civil and economic rights of African Americans. And in front of the Lincoln Memorial, Martin Luther King had Lincoln right behind him, all right? He had this I Have a Dream speech. It's a long speech, but it's beautiful and it's still meaningful. It is still meaningful. So if you have a chance, you know, listen to it, to see him, you have a film of this time. And you can read it too if you wanted to follow reading it. This is A. Philip Randolph, very important in these all these movements. He tried to have a march on Washington in 1944, right after the World War II, all right? But at the time, FDR, that's Franklin Delano Roosevelt, decided to give some things to the Black people. So the march was just, you know, was cold and it didn't happen, but this one really happened. So, and so, even though we face the difficulties of today and tomorrow, I still have a dream. It is a dream deeply rooted in the American dream. I have a dream that one day this nation will rise up and live out the true meaning of its creed. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. Do you believe that all men are created equal? Think about this. Wow. 16th Street Baptist Church bombing. I think this is one of the first scenes in the Selma film. And it was Sunday, September 15. People were in the church, and these four kids, 14-year-olds and one that was 11-year-old, they were playing inside the church. And what happened was that Eddie, Cynthia, Carol, and Carol, they died because there was a bomb planted on the side of the church. This is so sad. You know, for me to write these things, I cry when I'm writing because I feel, wow. So Martin Luther King said, one of the most vicious and tragic crimes ever perpetrated against humanity, and it was not fair. You know, there were no prosecutions till 1977. Robert Chambliss, there were four people involved, but in 1977, people see long time after, this man was tried and convicted, the first degree murder of one of the victims, that was the victim, the 11-year-old Carol. There were 14 to 22 people injured, and they four died. 80,000 people attended the funeral. This is outside the church. 80,000 people. People walked there to their funeral. Yeah, it makes us think. And we have the Black Power movement, because, you know, all this violence that was going on. Stokely Carmichael was fighting, as you know, in his neck. And after what happened there in Montgomery and then in Selma, he was arrested actually in Selma. And after he left, he decided, no, we need to be more radical than that. We cannot be silenced. We needed to scream out loud. And when they were walking from Selma to Montgomery, he started saying, what we need is Black Power. And he had his hand up like this. And that's the symbol that we are using for the Black History Month, all right? This is the symbol of athletes, that Black athletes that had their medals, but they were Black, and at home they had no rights. So we want Black Power, and that was the thing. People were just there watching their relatives die, all right? And you have in 1889, Huey P. Newton was fatally shot, because you have this Black Power movement, and Newton was the leader. The Selma to Montgomery marches were very meaningful. 87 kilometers, people walked. But it was not easy, okay? It was not easy. The first time they tried in Selma, the police came and beat people. And so Martin Luther King went to the city, not only him, but many leaders. Even there were leaders from the synagogue, and from the Catholic churches and from the other Christian churches, they went there, and SNCC people were there, and the CORE people were there, and FORE people were there, and all the movements were there. And they tried to walk 2 questions or 2 minutes. 2 minutes. Oh, okay. Let me finish this and then I'll answer the questions and we can close. So they only could get out of the city and the third trial, right? So they needed to cross this Edmund Pettus Bridge. You see the police beating people, and then you see people finally walking and getting out from Selma to Montgomery. And in 1964, finally, you have the Civil Rights Act that was signed by Lyndon Johnson. And it ended segregation in public places. That was a great victory. But it's still, as I answered the student, you know, too slow. This Civil Rights Act started with John Kennedy, but he could not get it through. And then you had the movements like the Black Panther Party. This guy sitting there with the guns, you know, the arms. And this is Newton. That's a lot. Oh, sorry. This woman down here, this is Angela Davis, a feminist, you know, a writer, and a Black. She was in the Black Panther for a while. I cannot read. Just a minute. Say that again. Ah, okay. Do I need to finish now? 5 minutes? Phew, I'm going to run now. Okay. Well, that's okay. We are going towards the end. So there was a march on Washington last year. Same date, August 28th. And people went there, and you know why? Because all the reasons we have seen on TV. I'll show you some reasons here. The New York Times had this headline saying, March on Washington 2020, protests hope to rekindle the spirit of 1963. It's like, let's take this flame from that time and take this again. So they went there. And, well, Black Lives Matter, BLM, right? The Black Lives Matter movement was still, you know, the Black Lives Matter movement, it's not new. It's been going on. I think it's just like, you know, the civil rights movement for me, it's very alive. But it was very meaningful because you see people with the masks. It is pandemic time and people went to the streets because you cannot have a you know, you cannot silence. So there are those who are asking the devotees of civil rights, when will you be satisfied? We can never be satisfied as long as the Negro is the victim of the unspeakable horrors of police brutality. And guys, this was said by Martin Luther King Jr. in 1963, and it's still so true. It's so true that you have the I Can Breathe movement also. And you have the Equal Justice Initiative. This is it's like a big company that's not only, you know, leading with the Black people, but everybody, you know, vulnerable people. They are fighting. This is a group that is fighting for justice. And here I got something from BBC News, and you have some reasons for people to go out and say Black Lives Matter. You have the case of Eric Garner, all right? You have a Breonna Taylor. You have George Floyd. This is the movement that was made after George Floyd was killed, all right? So Black Lives Matter. In Brazil, we have this too. Brazil is killing people too. It's killing Black people. So parem de nos matar, that's the thing. And vidas negras importam. It became our fight too. So the civil rights movement is on. right? And I believe that fighting for equal rights, looking for change, making sacrifices, that's what makes the movement go on, right? You travel by foot to say what you need. That's what you need to do, right? Fight for freedom. Be aware of what is happening around you. Fight for justice. Think about, is this just or not, all right? You can go to Spotify and you have some playlists that are very nice. Some of them I was playing here. And then we can go to the questions. Sorry, Letícia.
No problem, no problem, teacher. So we have a question from Victor Hugo Viana Viana. Was Martin Luther King the main force during these movements?
You know, as I said, Victor Hugo, it was much more. It was not only him. He was, you know, this face, this person was very strong, very intelligent. He knew how to say things. All these people I talked about, you know, Malcolm X, Stokely Carmichael, the Snake Boys, Bob Moses, and you have Randolph, and you have Rosa Parks. All of them were very meaningful for the movement, you know. And there were so many people working behind them. Here's the face. When we talk about Black History Month, the first face that comes to my mind is, oh, I need to talk about Martin Luther King Jr. Yes, all right. But there were writers, there was poetry, there was music, there were films, and there are still films coming in, all right? I saw in Netflix, there's a new series with Will Smith presenting. It is about the 14th Amendment. It is the name, I think, is Amend. You should see it. It is about the 14th Amendment. It's everything we're seeing here. Is this just? No, it's not. But, you know, Martin Luther King was not the only person. He was one in this multitude of people who were fighting.
Teacher, we have a question from Teacher Carolina Amazon. She introduced his question. Hi, Maris. Thanks for the outstanding lecture. Is Brazil part of any movement like the ones you're mentioning?
At that time, we had the military rule in Brazil. We had the dictatorship in Brazil. So, well, we had movements going on for sure. It was very dangerous, but we had the movements going on. We had, for example, from the 50s on, there was a Teatro do Negro, called the TEN, Teatro Experimental do Negro. And they would have a very, you know, revolutionary place at that time. There was music also, there were people writing about it. The movements were not so big as in the United States, but yes, there were. Thank you, Carol. I cannot hear you, Letícia.
Sorry. This question is from Taina Silva. Can you say the difference and similarities about the way USA and Brazil treat Black history? And what do you think this says about these nations?
Okay, there was a lot of fight, and I believe that, okay, this is the last question. Rafael is telling me that our time is over. Sorry. Let me go back to the answer. In the United States, there was a lot of fight, lots of movements and very strong movements. But, you know, I'm not going to say the racism was different there from here because it was not. But it worked, you know, in different systems. So we Brazilians, we still needed to treat our Black history with more respect than we are doing now. There are many people there writing, talking, discussing, studying, you know, what has happened to Blacks in Brazil. But we still have a lot to do. Wow.
Okay, thank you, teacher Maristela. Eu me sinto honrada de estar passando essas perguntas em inglês para você como aluna e deu. Muito obrigada. Muito obrigada, muito obrigada também pela sua valiosa contribuição com o nosso momento de comemorarmos o Black History Month. Gostaria de agradecer também a participação dos nossos teachers na pessoa da professora Flávia, Jéssica, Juliana, Juliane, Manuel, André Barreto, Marina, Cícero, Monique, Soraya, Herman, Alexandre e Gabriela Nobre. E também agradecer imensamente aos nossos queridos alunos que estiveram conosco participando, né, comentando, e também os que nos acompanharam através do nosso canal do YouTube. Agradecemos também ao suporte e apoio da Embaixada dos Estados Unidos e também, né, voltar aqui a agradecer a professora Maristela, que foi muito relevante, né, esse nosso momento de palestra, as questões levantadas aqui. Muito obrigada.
Thank you very much. Obrigada a todos, obrigada a toda a equipe que está aqui por trás, o Davidson, o Rafael e Letícia. Muito obrigada pelo suporte de vocês também aqui em tudo que aconteceu.